Well, we're gonna take it down a notch or two. Get a little funky. Call it a funky monkey. Neil Diamond. We had the most amazing songwriters writing for us. Neil Diamond, Neil Sedaka, Carol King, and Jerry Goffin. Paul Williams, Harry Nielsen, Boyce and Hart wrote some of the most amazing, amazing tunes. David Gates, Harry Nielsen, my good buddy. Amazing songwriters. We were blessed to have some of the greatest of all time. And actually, we started writing songs too, eventually. I'll tell you a little more about that later, but there was one guy in the group who wrote one of the best songs we ever did. In fact, it was so good, it was the closing theme song to the second season of the show. His name was Peter Tork, and this is For Pete's Sake. High school gymnasium, fluorescent lighting, that was it. John Lennon looks up at me and I swear to God, he looks up and he says, "Hey, monkey man, you wanna hear what we're working on?" And again, I'm trying to be so cool. I'm like, "Yeah, John, cool, yeah. What you got?" Weed my pants again. He points up to George Martin, who's up in the booth, wearing a three-piece suit in the middle of the day. He pushes a button on a four-track tape recorder. This is what I hear.
Thank you.
90s. It was before he was Jimi Hendrix, to some degree. The story is, I saw him in New York playing guitar as a sideman for, I think it was John Hammond Band down in the Village, and we were invited down to see the band and see this young kid playing guitar with his teeth. Sure enough, they're playing along, and there's this kid playing the guitar behind his neck with his teeth, and amazing, amazing guy. I don't even remember if I knew his name at the time. Well, a few months later, I'm at the Monterey Pop Festival, and I'm watching all these incredible acts come on stage, The Who and Mamas and Papas and, you know, everybody. And all of a sudden, these three guys walk on with the most incredible psycho cello outfits and satin and things, and they start playing, and I go, that's the guy that plays guitar with his teeth. Sure enough, it was him. Now, we were looking for an opening act at the time for our upcoming first big Monkey tour, and I said to my producers, wow, you gotta look at this act, this is amazing. They're very theatrical, and they were, of course. And the Monkees was essentially a theatrical act. And I guess their people liked it, our people liked it, and sure enough, we're on. Now, it's always kind of tricky for an opening act, opening for a big headliner. You've heard stories of Axl Rhodes opening for the Stones and things like that. It's tough. Well, I'm gonna show you. This is exactly, I'm not kidding. Honest to God's truth, this is exactly what it was like. Jimi Hendrix opening for the Monkees. In Beverly Hills, but we'd go to work every day until midnight and come home, go to sleep, go to work, go to sleep, go to work. We kept listening to the radio, but we never heard it. We missed it. Kept missing this darn song. Well, one day, we're driving back from work, and we pull in the driveway. I'm just about ready to turn off the car, and this is what I hear! Cause I'm leaving in the morning. what kale was. And weed. Naturally. Was the 60s. Yes, it was the 60s. It was the summer of love. 1966-67. So everybody was very friendly, and frankly, a lot of people were walking around naked. You know, swinging 60s, free love, I mean, the whole thing. Well, I was up there all the time. For the kale. And one day, I'm sitting there by the pool, my feet dangling in the pool, and Stephen comes up with his guitar, and he sits down right next to me and by the pool, and he says, "Hey, Mickey, I want to play you this really cool tune that I'm going to record. We're recording. It's going to be our first thing." So I'm like, "Wow, very cool. Cool, Stephen." And this is what I hear. Something's happening here. What it is ain't exactly clear. There's a man with a gun over there telling me I've got to beware. Oh, children, let me stop. Hey, what's that sound? Everybody look what's going down. If anybody's wrong, young people speaking their mind, getting so much resistance from behind. It's time to stop. Hey, what's that sound? Everybody look what's going down. Linda Ronstadt is the first one that comes to mind, for instance. Mike Nesmith. Sorry, washed my tongue today. I can't do a thing with it. Mike Nesmith, when I first met him, after we were cast, he was the Hootenanny Master on Monday nights. An incredible place. Well, one night a friend of mine says, "Hey, you got to come down to the Troubadour to hear this kid, this singer-songwriter kid from England. He's amazing, a great little band. Come down and you know, come to the show. It's like his U.S. Premiere, you know, his opening night." So I go down to the Troubadour, and sure enough, this kid is amazing. He's great. He's great songs, great performance. His name was Elton John. So my friend says after the show, he says, "Hey, I'm having an after-show party for Elton John at my little house in Hollywood. Come on by, please." So my wife and I say, "Yeah, sure, cool." Because there was a lot of people there that I knew, and so we all, now my wife was English, and she would go back and forth to England all the time, and she would bring me back really cool clothes from Carnaby Street, the Apple Store, Biba's, I mean, all these amazing 60s gear, you know, was amazing. And she brought back this t-shirt, and it was the Andy Warhol Marilyn Monroe in multi-images. You've probably seen the painting. Somebody made t-shirts out of this incredible painting. And I was like, cool. So I wore it to the Troubadour that night, very proudly. And we go, after the show, we go to this party in this little house in Hollywood. And we walk in, of course everybody's there, all my friends. So, hey, what's up? And my friend says, hey, come on into the kitchen and meet Elton John. You know, and I'm like, oh, cool, yes, great. And so I walk into the kitchen, and I'll never forget it. There's Elton John leaning up against the refrigerator with a beer, wearing the same t-shirt. And I swear to God, he looks at me and goes, oh, fuck. This is the song he opened with at the Troubadour. It's a little bit funny, this feeling inside, and I'm not one who can easily hide. I don't have much money, but boy, if I did, I'd buy a big house where we both could live. But then again, no. Or a man who sells potions in a trashum. I know it's not much. It's the best I can do. My gift is my song, and this one's for you. You can tell everybody this is your song. It may be quite simple, but now that you know, I hope you don't mind. I hope you don't mind that I put down in words how wonderful life is when you're. Sat on the roof and kicked off the moss on a few of the verses. They got me quite cross, but the sun was quite high while I wrote this song. It's for people like things I do, I keep forgetting. Are they green or are they blue? But anyway, the thing is, what I really need, yours are the sweetest eyes I've ever seen. And you can tell everybody this is your song. It may be quite simple, but now that it's known, I hope you don't mind. I hope you don't mind that I put down in words how wonderful the life is. I hope you don't mind. I hope you don't mind that I put down in words how wonderful life is while you're in the world.
Thank you.
But by far the guy that wrote some of the best songs in the group was Michael Nesmith. Unbelievable singer-songwriter. But one of the best songs he ever wrote, the Monkees never recorded, and I'll tell you why. He wrote this before he even was in the Monkees, before he was cast into the show. And when we started, got up and running, he brought his guitar into the producers. He said, I want to play this song that I want to record with the Monkees. Yeah. And he played the song, and they said, oh, that's nice, but thank you, but no thank you. It's not a Monkee tune. He said, wait a minute, I am one of the friggin' Monkees. And they said, yeah, we know, but don't call us, we'll call you. So in Mike's inimitable way, he kind of went. And he gave the song to a young girl singer, a newcomer on hanging around town, kicking around town at the time. Since I'm not a young girl singer, I'm gonna ask my lovely sister Coco to come out here and sing this Mike Nesmith tune. Recorded by Linda Ronstadt, the Stone Ponies called Different Toronto.
Yeah. Dream believer.
Stewart, who wrote that wonderful song. John Stewart was one of the original Kingston Trio. Got another little story here, if you don't mind, a quick one. Do we have any members of the armed service, present or past, in the audience here? Thank you. Thank you so much for your service. Thank you. I was after a show, great show and everything, but I got a quick story. In the 60s, during the Cold War, I was in the Navy. In fact, I was a submariner. I was on a submarine, a nuclear submarine, underneath the Arctic for like 600 years. It was like 6 months or something. It was weird, incredible. He said, we were under the Arctic, and we were playing cat and mouse with a Russian sub. And Cold War, remember, and they were trying to find us. We knew we were trying to find them. They knew we were there. We knew they were there. But they were running silent, running deep. Everything was quiet. All these sailors had to take off their shoes and tiptoe around, not talk, whispering. They had the speakers all cranked up in the control room, listening, you know, for a ping, for any noise of the Russian sub, trying to find each other. And they knew the Russians were doing the same thing, tiptoeing around, speakers up to full volume, listening for any sign of the American sub. And he said eventually, after I think he said weeks, playing cat and mouse, the Russians pinged us, they found us, they knew we were there. And so when the captain of the American sub realized that, basically he said, "Ah, screw it," and told the sound guy, knowing the Russians had all their speakers up full blown, he said, "Screw it, hit it, and this is what the Russians hear." Opportunity to introduce to you one of the finest bands I have ever played with. Starting over here, on background vocals and keyboards, and our vocal arranger, give it up for Mr. Alex Jules! On background vocals and guitar, please say hello to Amin Zarukian. You met her once before, but please say hello again to my beloved sister, Coco. Over here on the drums, the most incredible drummer of all time, Buddy Rich. You're not Buddy Rich? Oh, that's right. No, my Buddy Rich. Rich Tart, give it up. Over here. Last but not least, whose birthday it is coming up on Monday. Certainly, last but not least, my musical director and guitar player extraordinaire. Please give it up for Mr. Wayne Avers. Stuff in there. daylight saving Kevin. I forgot to leave it no place, but I still froze on where we got to go. Knew I should have taken off my shoes. There's some page new. Go down. Run down. Let's go on now. you know what that is. But I want you to go home. Any little kids in the audience? No, probably not. Oh, yes. Hi, little kid. I don't want you to forget that I sang this song long before Shrek.
Hey, it's a sucker!